Dear students, welcome to the English second paper class brought to you by Amar Ghore Amar School. You know that during the pandemic situation, the government has taken decision to close down all your schools. But Amar Ghore Amar School has taken initiative to bring your classroom to your home through Sanshad Bangladesh Television. So let's start today's class. The topic that we are going to learn today is present perfect and present perfect continuous tense. You may find this lesson in your book at Unit 2 in Lesson 4 and 5. Now, in this picture, what we can see? We can see that there is a person who is watering plant. So, he is doing something right now. On the other hand, there is a other person who has finished his work and the picture has been given at the back. So at first, the first person that the work has finished, here it has been labeled as has gardened, and the person who is still watering the plant, he has been labeled as has been gardening. Now in the second picture, we can see that a conversation is going on. In the first picture, we can see that a frog is saying, "What have you been doing?" And then a cat is replying, "Nothing, I have just arrived." Now what we can see here, there has been two different structures of verbs that have been used here. The first one, have been doing, and the second one, I have just arrived, is completely different in case of the structure. So dear students, have you understood what we are going to learn today? The topic that we are going to focus on today is present perfect and present perfect continuous tense. So what will be the learning outcome of today's class? After today's class, you'll be able to understand the uses of present perfect and present perfect continuous tense. You'll be able to write sentences correctly using the correct structure of present perfect and present perfect continuous. And last but not the least, you'll be able to ask and answer questions using present perfect and present perfect continuous tense. Now, how can we define present perfect tense? We use present perfect to talk about completed actions or states which are still connected to the present, which means that the event or action has already been over, but the result or event effect is still right now present at the moment. It is still connected to the present. For example, he has been to 10 different countries. I haven't seen her today. My phone has run out of battery. Have you ever dyed your hair a different color? In all these examples, you can see that at first we have used the subject, then we have used have or has as the to-be verb, then we have used past participle form of the verb. In all these actions, there's something in common, which is these actions, events, effects are still present at the moment and they're still connected. Now let's have a look at the uses of present perfect tense. We use present perfect tense for completed actions with a result in the present. We can use the present perfect to talk about an action that has been finished, but it has a result or effect in the present. For example, he has broken his leg, so he cannot go on holiday. They haven't called me, so I don't think they need me today. Now, the first example, someone has broken his leg, and because of his injury, he is not being able to go on a holiday. So the injury's result has been present, and for this effect, he is not being able to go on a holiday. In the second one, they haven't called me, so I don't think they need me today. The effect or the result of calling is still there. For this reason, we have used present perfect tense in here. We can also use present perfect tense for unfinished time and states. We also use it to talk about life experiences, as our life is an unfinished time period. So as a person, my life experience is a part of my own and it is unfinished. For this reason, we can use present perfect tense in case of life experiences. For example, I have worked for 6 different companies. That means I have already worked for 6 different companies, but there is a possibility that I might work in other companies as well. Since it is unfinished, for this reason we have used perfect tense in here. Now the second one, he has never won a gold medal. And the third one, have you ever been to Australia? Even these two actions are a part of life experience. Since life experience is unfinished time, for this reason we have used present perfect tense. Now let's see the structure of present perfect tense in case of affirmative sentence. In case of affirmative sentence, we are going to start the sentence with the subject. Then we have or has, depending on the subject. Then we are going to use the past participle form of the verb. For example, I have worked. Now we know that the past participle form of the verb work is worked. And why have we used have here? Because the subject is first person singular number. In case of third person singular number, as in he, she, it, or any other singular subject, we are going to use has. In all other cases, we are going to use have, and then we are going to use the past participle form of the verb. We use present perfect in the affirmative form to confirm completed actions which have occurred in the past, are connected to the present, and still have effects in it. Now the negative structure. The negative structure of present perfect tense is quite similar to affirmative sentence. Since it is negative, we are just going to add not after have or has. For example, I haven't been abroad yet. You haven't answered my question. He hasn't been home for 5 years. She hasn't found a new job. It has not finished yet. We have not worked on a farm. They have not seen each other for ages. In all these cases, what we have done, at first we have used the subject, then we have used have not or has not, and then we have used the past participle form of the verb. In both cases, we have started the question by using have or has, then we have used the subject, and then we have used the past participle form of the verb. We use present perfect in the interrogative form to ask about completed actions which have occurred in the past, are connected to the present, and still have effects on it. In case of interrogative sentence, we are going to use the question mark at the end. Now, if you want to use WH question, what can we do? In case of WH question, we are going to ask the question by putting the WH word at the beginning of the sentence. And the rest of the structure is going to be the same as interrogative sentence. For example, where have you studied for the exam? When has he bought a new car? In both these cases, we can see that where and when, the WH word has been put at the beginning. Then we have used have or has, then the subject, and then the past participle form of the main verb. And in all these cases, if there is something, for example, object or complement, we are going to put that after the past participle form of the verb. And yes, do not forget to use the question mark. Now let's have a look of present perfect continuous tense. The present perfect continuous tense is used to show that an action started in the past and has continued up to the present moment. As you can see in this picture, The green line, it is referring to an event. As you can see, it has started in the past. But up to now, up to present moment, it is being continued. For this reason, we have used present perfect continuous tense in here. If you use present perfect continuous tense in positive sentence, the structure is going to be as follows. At first, we are going to have the subject. Then we are going to have or has. We are going to use been. And then we are going to have verb plus ing. For example, I have been speaking. I have been reading. He has been crying. She has been cooking. We have been skiing. He has been telling. In all these cases, what we can see, when we have third person singular number as the subject, for example, he, she, or it, we have used has. In all other cases, we have used have as the be verb. If you want to make negative sentence using present perfect continuous tense, it's very easy to form. We are just going to add not after have or has. For example, we have not been living in Germany. You have not been living in Germany. So it's very easy to understand. We are going to use the same structure as affirmative sentence. Just the difference is, since it is negative, we are going to add not. Now, if you want to ask a question or pose a question using present perfect continuous tense, you are going to use have or has at the beginning of the sentence. For example, has she been sleeping? Have you been speaking? In all these cases, what we have done, we have used have or has as the beginning. Then we are going to use the subject. We have used been, and then we have used verb plus ing. And yes, do not forget to use the question mark. Now, there is a confusion. Where can we use for and where can we use since? If you are referring to a time or duration for a period of time that has been happening, you can use for. On the other hand, when the time refers to a point in past time or when the action began, we are going to use since. For example, 20 minutes, 3 days, 6 months. All these are referring to a duration for how long the action or event has been happening. For example, I have been living here for 3 years. So this is a duration of my living. For this reason, I have used for. On the other hand, if I say it has been raining since Monday, that means the action of raining started or began on Monday. For this reason, since it is referring to a period of time when the action started, we have used since. So again, I'm repeating, if you have duration, you're going to use for. If you have the point when the action began, you're going to use since. So what have we learned in today's class? In today's class, we have learned that present perfect tense is used for actions that have ended but has an effect in the present. And we use the present perfect continuous tense to indicate that something began in the past and is continuing up to now. Dear students, now it's time for homework. Today I'm going to give you two homework. The first one can be found at page number 33 in your prescribed book. So as you can see, there are some clues given. You have to make correct sentences in the present perfect tense using the given words. The first one is, we start our journey. Next, Reba wash her clothes. They buy a new car. She learned the lesson. he not come back from school, you take a bath. So the sentences have not been completed. You are going to complete them and rewrite them using the present perfect tense. Now this is the second one that you have to do as your homework. It can be found at page number 34. You have to complete the following dialogue using the tense that should be appropriate in here. Reza, how long have you been waiting here? Anwar. So as Reza has asked the question using present perfect continuous tense, of course the answer must be in present perfect continuous tense also. Then again Reza has asked another question, as we can see a question mark at the end, and then Anwar replied, I have been looking for you since morning. Dear students, do the homework. Submit it to your respective teacher when the school reopens. The evaluation given by your teacher will be added to your continuous assessment. I hope you have enjoyed today's lesson. If you want to watch this class again, go to our Facebook page, Amar Ghore Amar School, or you can watch it in the YouTube channel, Amar Ghore Amar School. Thank you. Stay safe.
Dear students of class 7, welcome to today's program, Amar Ghore, Amar School. Once again, I am with you. I am Soyed Firoz Alam. Dear students, how are you? I hope all of you are well by the grace of Almighty Allah. Today, I am going to take a class from English for Today book. It is Unit 5 and Lesson 2 and 3. You can see the title of this unit, Great Women to Remember. Okay, let us know the learning outcomes of this unit. After we have studied this unit, we will be able to ask and answer questions, talk about people, read and understand text, write answers to questions, write short paragraphs and compositions, understand and enjoy stories, poems and other text materials. Here, you can see the learning outcomes of this unit. Now, let us know the learning outcomes of lesson 2. After we have studied this lesson, we will be able to ask and answer questions, read and understand text, write answers to multiple choice questions, write answers to questions. Dear students, you can see the learning outcomes of lesson 2. Let us move on to our next slide. In the previous class, I gave you a homework. I hope all of you have done it. I told you to write a paragraph on Begum Rokia. Okay, let's start our today's lesson. In this picture, you can see Begum Rokia. So our today's lesson is Begum Rokia part 2. Read these questions first, then listen to the teacher or CD and answer to the questions. Question number 1, What did Begum Rokeya do to make people remember her husband? Question number two. Do you know what kind of books she wrote? Dear learners, can you guess the answer? Okay, let's see the answer. Question number one. What did Begum Rokeya do to make people remember her husband? The answer is Begum Rokeya established Shakawat Hussain Memorial Girls School to make people remember her husband. Question number two. Do you know what kind of books she wrote? The answer is she wrote novels and stories. So I hope the answers are clear to you. Let's move to our next slide. Listening text 6. I have the text for you. Begum Rokeya's husband, Shakawat Hussain, died in 1909. Begum Rokeya's husband, Shakawat Hussain, who died in 1909. 5 months after his death, Rokeya set up a high school for girls in Bhagalpur. 5 months after his death, Rokeya set up a high school for girls in Bhagalpur. In memory of her husband, it was named Shakawat Memorial Girls High School. She established the school in memory of her husband. And for this reason, the school was named Shakawat Memorial Girls High School. There was a dispute among the members of her husband's family over the school land. There was a dispute in her husband's family over the school land. Later, the school was moved to Kolkata. For this reason, later the school was moved to Kolkata. The school is now one of the most popular schools for girls. Now, it is run by the Porchim Bangla State. Rokeya started her literary career in 1902 with a Bangla story entitled Pipasha. And it was named Pipasha. She wrote a good number of short stories and novels. Her publications are Sultana's Dream and Poddurag. Begum Rokeya died of a massive heart attack on 9th December 1932. By a massive heart attack. So let's do some exercise from this lesson. Listen again and tick the best answer. You can see some multiple choice questions in the screen. The first one is Shakawat Hussain died in 1902, 1909, 1932. Dear learners, can you guess the answer? Yes, the answer is 1909. Number two, Begum Rokeya set up a girls' school in Kolkata, Bhagalpur, Pairabandh. Which one is correct? Yes, Begum Rokeya set up a girls' high school in Bhagalpur. Okay, let's move on to our next slide. Begum Rokeya set up this school in memory of her husband, father, mother. Yes, the correct answer is husband. Number four, there was a dispute in her husband's family. Here, dispute means that the members were of the same opinion, had different opinions, did not like each other. The answer is number B, had different opinions. Next, Shakawat Hussain Memorial Girls School is a private school, a government school, a Muslim school. Dear learners, in the passage you have seen that it is now run by Porchim Bangla State. So, it is a government school. Number six, Begum Rokeya wrote short stories and poems, novels and short stories. Which one is correct? Yes, it is number C, novels and short stories. Here you can see some questions. First one, what did Begum Rokeya do for female education? Number two, why did she move Shakhat Memorial Girls High School to Kolkata? Number three, what are some of her important writings? Dear learners, can you guess the answer? Okay, do you want to see the answer? Okay, let's see it. Number one, what did Begum Rokeya do for female education? The answer is, Begum Rokeya established Shakhawat Memorial Girls High School for female education. Question number two. Why did she move Shakhawat Memorial Girls High School to Kolkata? The answer is, she moved Shakhawat Memorial Girls High School to Kolkata because there was a dispute among the members of her husband's family over the school land. Number C, or question number three, what are some of her important writings? The answer is, some of her important writings are Motichur, Sultana's Dream, Poddorag, etc. So, that's all from this lesson. I hope this lesson is clear to you. Now, we will move on to our next lesson. It is lesson 3. First, let us learn the learning outcomes of lesson 3. After we have studied this lesson, we will be able to ask and answer questions, read and understand text, match words with their meanings, write answers to true or false, write answers to multiple choice questions. So, here you can see the learning outcomes of lesson 3. Let's move on to our next slide. Guess the pictures. In the screen, you can see two pictures. Do you know who is she? Do you know her name? Yes, she is Helen Keller. So, our today's lesson is Lesson 3, Helen Keller, Part 1. First, you can see some keywords here. First one, humanitarian, then disabled, inventor, plantation. Humanitarian, it means a person who seeks to promote human welfare. Disabled, it generally refers a person. It means having a physical or mental condition that limits their movements, senses, or activities. Inventor, it means a person who invented a particular process or device, or who invents things as an occupation. Plantation, it means an area in which trees have been planted especially for commercial purposes. So, you have learned the meanings of these words. Let's move on to our lesson today. Lesson 3, Helen Keller Part 1, already you have learned the keywords. Now, talk about the picture. Who is the woman in the picture? Do you know who is the woman? Yes, she is Helen Keller. And what is she famous for? She is famous for her social work. She helped the disabled people. Okay, let's start our today's lesson. Read about Helen Keller. Helen Keller was a great humanitarian. She worked for the welfare of human beings. She deeply cared for the people who were sick and injured. She took deep care for the people who were sick and injured. These disabled people could not use a part of their body. Helen Helen worked for these disabled people all through her life, and all through her life, she worked for such kind of disabled people. Helen Keller was born in 1880 in Tuscumbia, Albania. Her father was Captain Arthur Keller and mother Catherine Adams Keller. So, you can see that Helen Keller was born in 1880 in Tuscumbia, Alabama. Her father was named Captain Arthur Keller and her mother was Catherine Adams Keller. Her family was not raised and its main source of income was cotton plantation. They got income from cotton plantation. Helen was quite healthy when she was born. But in 1882, she had a high fever. And she became blind, deaf and dumb. And it is a matter of regret that she became blind, deaf and dumb. At that time, her father was a newspaper editor. He told Alexander Graham Bell about Helen. Her father knew Alexander Graham Bell and he told about Helen to him. Bell, the inventor of telephone, we know that Bell invented telephone, was working with deaf children that time. And Bell was working with deaf children at that time. Later, Bell met Helen and her parents. He suggested Perkins School for the blind in Boston for Helen. And he suggested Helen's parents to send her to Perkins School in Boston. Captain Arthur went to the director of the school, Michael Anaganos. Mr. Anaganos sent one of his best students called Annie Sullivan to help Helen in 1887. Captain Arthur went to meet the director of the school and his name was Michael Anaganos. Mr. Anaganos sent one of his best students named Annie Sullivan to help Helen in 1887. Annie greatly helped Helen to communicate and that student helped Helen greatly to communicate. So, this is all from this passage. Let's do some exercise from this passage. Here you can see a matching. You have to match the words with their meanings. Words in the left columns are humanitarian, disabled, plantation, inventor. And on the right column you can see the first one, a large area of land where crops like sugar, banana, etc. are grown. Second one, a person who has discovered something. Third one, making people's sufferings less and improving their living conditions. And fourth one, unable to use a part of the body easily or completely because of illness, injury, etc. Okay, let us match these words with their meanings. Humanitarian, it means making people's suffering less and improving their living conditions. Disabled, it means unable to use a part of the body easily or completely because of illness, injury, etc. Plantation means a large area of land where crops like sugar, banana, etc. are grown. And inventor, it means a person who has discovered something. So, dear learners, I hope this matching is clear to you. Now, let's move on to our next slide. It is time to give you some homework from this lesson. Dear learners, here you can see true or false. If false, you have to give the correct answer. Here the first one, Helen always helped the suffering people. Second one, she came from a rich family. Third one, she was born blind, deaf and dumb. Fourth one, Alexander Graham Bell was both an inventor and a social worker. Fifth one, Annie Sullivan was a good teacher of Helen Keller. To answer this true or false, you have to read the text carefully. Now, you can see some other homework from this lesson. It is multiple choice questions. You have to choose correct answers from these given answers. You have to do it. Dear students, if you want to see this class again,